people will regard as time travel. Actually, the book speculates that we won't actually be traveling to a different time, but we'll be traveling to a different event through resonance travel. So each event has unfolded and stacked in layers at a single point. There's a present time that may be moving, but it's a single point through all these layers of possibility. But each different possibility or event or outcome, if it's something we perceived as happening in 1815, it's actually happened now, but it's at a certain event that has its own specific resonance. There's an associated resonance, just like the global consciousness experiment. There might be a certain resonance to the world when the World Trade Centers came down. And at that particular resonance, if you can figure out what that exact resonating frequency is, and you can dial in a machine to that exact resonance, you could transport to that. Love is the one frequency. There's an associated frequency with love. And in the book, it states, Doc claims that there is no way that you can destroy that particular frequency, and that love is only manifested within human consciousness, and it exists after you're gone, and it's out there, that all you really have to leave behind is this love, and you need to hold on to it, because that's what transports you from this world. That's what, when your physical body's gone, that's what exists, and that's what goes on.
Yo, this is OCCULTURE. I am Ryan Peverly. Welcome to the show. Thank you for being here. You picked a good time to stop in because we've got one hell of an episode with Craig Smedley, author of Quantum Orchestra, Distorting the Notes of Reality. Craig and I are going to be talking about some thought-provoking ideas found in his book. That conversation is just around the bend. But first, my thanks to VHS Dreams. You're listening to his song Frequencies. There's a link in the show notes to the track on SoundCloud if you're interested in checking it out. Again, very appropriate title for this episode, which we're going to get to right now. Craig Smedley's work as a civilian contractor at classified government facilities, including Los Alamos National Laboratory and Sandia National Laboratories, served as a valuable experience for writing his first novel, the aforementioned Quantum Orchestra, Distorting the Notes of Reality. And yes, this is a work of fiction, but we should know by now that truth is buried in fiction, and Craig's book seems to be no exception. It is, after all, as he states, based on his experiences as a government contractor at these national labs. Sandia, for those who are unfamiliar with that facility, is a U.S. Department of Energy research lab in Albuquerque, New Mexico. Their primary mission is to maintain the reliability and surety of nuclear weapons systems, conduct research and development in arms control and non-proliferation technologies, and investigate methods for the disposal of the United States nuclear weapons program's hazardous waste. Other missions include research and development in energy and environmental programs, as well as the surety of critical national infrastructures. In addition, Sandia is home to a wide variety of research, including computational biology, mathematics, material science, alternative energy, psychology, microelectromechanical systems, and cognitive science initiatives. Now, Los Alamos, on the other hand, is just north of Albuquerque and is also a U.S. Department of Energy research lab. This is the facility that developed the first nuclear weapons during the Manhattan Project. According to their website, they conduct multidisciplinary research in fields such as national security, whatever that is, space exploration, renewable energy, medicine, nanotechnology, and supercomputing. Their mission statement is to solve national security challenges, again, whatever those are, through scientific excellence. Their vision is to deliver science and technology to protect our nation and promote world stability. I'll let you be the judge of that, if they're living up to that mission and that vision after hearing this conversation. So Craig Smedley has intimate knowledge of the inner workings of these facilities. Sorting through the ideas in his book was no easy task, both from a research standpoint and from an emotional standpoint. I said the information in here is very thought-provoking. It absolutely is. It's also quite heavy. If even 10% of what's in this book is true, we're pretty much fucked. And that's all I want to say about this up front here. This is a great chat, and I hope you enjoy it. Here it is. Craig Smedley, hey man, thanks for taking the time here tonight. I really appreciate it.
Yep, glad to be here.
Awesome. So the book is Quantum Orchestra, Distorting the Notes of Reality. Before we talk about what's inside the book, let's talk about you for a minute or two here and where you've been in your life, what you've done professionally that influenced this book of yours.
Well, basically, I graduated from Ohio University. I'm just a good old Ohio boy, been here for a long time. Moved out to New Mexico, got a job at an engineering company out there. Was fortunate enough to work at some government labs like Los Alamos National Labs, Sandia Labs, a NASA facility. And I had a lot of experiences out there. During that work, learned a lot, focused a lot on physics, but it was also environmental related work. While doing that type of work, a lot of things came to my attention about how government labs operate, about some of the things that they do, the effects of these things they do, consequences. And this book, to me, there were things I needed to share with the world. So this is a work of fiction that I wrote, but it's based on true experiences. I don't think if it were not a work of fiction, I could even tell the story. I think there's some sensitive areas I touch on this book. So basically that is what this book is. And I came to a point in my life where things had happened and I knew now was the time to write it or it would never get written.
So you were in New Mexico working as a contractor for several government facilities, as you just outlined. And this book is a work of fiction, like you said, but it's based on your experiences during this time.
That's right.
And then also up through the present day, right? To some level.
Yes, that's right.
Before we even get into what's in the book, how much of the book from like a percentage scale of 1 to 100, how much of this is actually true?
Well, it's really hard to put a percentage on it. I would say the majority of it, it's all founded in science, and the science behind it is real, and the science behind it is true. Now, you can speculate about if the things that come to pass in the book could really happen. It's possible. So, you know, the science and the background for the science is real, 100% real.
Okay. Well,
I can't put a percentage on it. You know, the characters are all based on real people that I know, real people that I met, experiences I've had through my life. So there's a lot of truth.
Okay, let's get into the book then. Let's talk about, you know, who some of these characters are, what their roles are in the story, and then maybe talk about the plot a little bit as well, and then hopefully get into some of the ideas. Well, no, we will get into some of the ideas that are presented here, but just tell people a little bit about what the book is about on the surface.
Yeah. On the surface, it's a journey. A young man meets a physicist while working at Los Alamos. This physicist has a warning and is involved in some programs that he needs to warn the world about. And he recruits a young guy to help him on this mission. Life progresses, experiences happen, people change. The young man changes and grows, and he's affected by his experiences. And I guess you could say that the journey, just like the science is now leaning towards more becoming mythical, that matter may be a mythical thing based on quantum physics. And just like the young man's life, it takes more of a spiritual journey, and it all comes together in the end.
Yeah, it absolutely does. The physicist character that you're talking about here, you call him Doc throughout the book. Actually, when you first meet him, you don't really know his name. He kind of uses a few aliases or pseudonyms,
right,
or whatever. But eventually, you know, you do kind of reveal who he is, like his real name in the book, obviously, and then he's just referred to as Doc from there on. But
yeah, like everyone else at Los Alamos, you know, he's under scrutiny and suspicion. He knows secrets from the lab, and he works with very sensitive information. So he has no identity. When you work there, you're stripped of your identity. You're not allowed to share it. So he purposely keeps it to himself.
Right. And then the protagonist of the story, you know, who we're seeing these events unfold through, is Tony, And Tony, I'm assuming, is you, obviously, on some level. I don't know how much liberty you took in terms of character development, but it seems, you know, just from off-air conversations with you, it seems like that's who this is. It's you writing as Tony, right?
Yeah, I would definitely say it's semi-autobiographical. And Tony, his voice comes from experiences I've had. Not 100%, because there, as I said, there are certain things in the book that, you know, if I were to come out and say this is fact, and they happen to be right on just by chance, that wouldn't be good for me.
Well, let's talk about some of those things, because it's hard to describe the book without talking about the ideas in it. You know, I mean, you just start with the title Quantum Orchestra, and right there, like, that sums up what this book is about. It's a quantum level story about sound and vibration and frequency and how that really interacts with our environment and with us biologically as well.
Absolutely.
Let's go to that first time in the book that Tony meets Doc while working at Los Alamos. Before Doc even gets into anything with Tony about science or physics, he goes on this great rant about when grain was introduced to man's diet.
Right. Yeah.
And I found that to be really interesting, because the way that he describes it, he calls it, it marks the point of man's physical degradation.
That's right.
When grain was introduced to man's diet. That's a great thought. It's a great idea. Yeah. It's one I've had before, too. It's one I've heard before.
Yeah.
Because the point here is that through farming, we've shifted the balance of the environment.
Exactly. We start to control it rather than being part of it or one with it. I think there's a point that's expounded upon it in a chapter where Tony meets the Native American, the Zia Pueblo, the elder. He meets him, and he talks about how there was a woman that was sick, that was very sick, and she needed food. And finally, another man had sold her a piece of, or sold her some fruit. She gave him a little piece of gold. And the Native American mentions how, you know, that there is a problem. The woman should have just accepted her fate and died, and the man shouldn't have taken the gold. Because then they started seeing, you know, they started selling fruit and things like that. But the point is, the woman had forgotten that she's truly a spiritual being, and that her time here as a physical being is just a temporary thing and gone with it. But she fought it. You know, she feared death. And then Doc, in the beginning, what you're talking about, he talks about how, and I've thought about this a lot, too. Once we started farming, you know, you no longer had to be the fastest or the strongest to survive. Basically, we knocked the world out of balance because we started using the resources too fast, and we started feeding everyone. And people now just go to the supermarket. They don't need to go out in their garden and pick fruit. The balance of nature shifted at that point when we introduced grains and started farming land instead of being sustaining ourselves on available resources.
Absolutely. You know, I tell people in my personal life all the time that balance is key in everything that we do. And the point that you make in the book, the point that you just made, is that we're out of balance now. We're controlling our environment too much, really.
Yes.
And I have a quote here from Doc. He says, "We've evolved into a parasitic race, and we will ravage our host planet until its immune system figures out how to destroy it, us." And I love that because it's true, or at least it feels true to me, because it seems that, and tell me if you agree or disagree, that we're reflections of the universe at large, you know, the whole macrocosm, microcosm, as above, so below.
That's right.
So someone might hear a passage like that and say, well, the Earth doesn't have an immune system. Well, bull fucking shit, it doesn't.
Yeah, it absolutely does.
Every living thing on the planet does. Why wouldn't the planet itself?
Right. It's a living organism. And it does seem like that's happening. Maybe it's through cancer. You know, maybe that's how it's fighting us off. Maybe, I mean, we're the parasite it's trying to rid. It just, you can see it every day. And and as far as the macrocosm, microcosm, and I'm sure we'll get into that, where we talk about the fact that quantum energy and quantum ether, which is talked about a lot in the book, and our connection to that, we are it. You know, it flows through us. We are quantum ether, and we're not separate from it.
Absolutely, yeah, and that you're right. That does play a large role in the book in terms of a theme and ideas. And I do have several notes and questions about that. You know, just to wrap up this point, though, about the grains and the diet and controlling the environment, it's interesting to me because, and this is a point made in the book by the doc character, that, you know, the FDA and the government as a whole aren't going to tell us that, you know, this stuff is what's making us sick and causing all these diseases. Because they're working for agribusinesses, not the common citizen. So as someone who's worked in government facilities as a private contractor, is this a common sentiment? Do you guys just know that the government's not really working for people like you, people like us?
I think that there's a tendency of those employees to kind of turn their cheek to it, not really look at it for what it really is. But once you step outside of it, you know, they're being fed by the government. This is where their income comes from. So they don't want to admit that, you know, the corruption and everything and what's really happened to the environment. But you're absolutely right as far as the FDA and everything. I mean, they're getting their money from agribusiness. If they were to step up right now, because they introduced this whole thing about a balanced diet, you need to have grains and everything in the 70s maybe, and that was the balanced diet. And they, from there, have, you know, they've just made agribusiness so rich, and they just get so much in return, so much kickback from that. They could never come out at this point and say, wow, we're realizing now that there's certain molecules in bread and a gluten and that attacks certain organs. It actually mimics viruses, and then your body will attack its own organs and things like that. You're never going to hear that.
The agribusiness wouldn't be in business anymore. So, yeah, I can understand why they would never do that. Well, actually, I take that back. I don't understand why, because they're killing people for profit, essentially. But anyways, so...
Yeah, we know that. You know that. I know that. And I think most people with common sense know that. But I don't know if there's that much common sense anymore.
Well, we can get to that later. So, it's around this point in the story, too. I mean, we're still early on here, the first chapter or two, even. Doc and Tony are first meeting each other. They're first getting to know each other. And Doc is laying down all of this stuff to Tony. And Tony, you know, for lack of a better term, he sees Doc as kind of like a kooky conspiracy theorist type.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah.
But Doc actually gives Tony some information that shows Tony how serious Doc is about what he says. And it's information that leads Tony to find the body of a missing girl.
That's right. I don't think there's any backlash with me telling you that's an absolutely 100% true story.
Right.
Doc, he had to prove himself to Tony because Doc's a genius, but Doc knew that Tony was very skeptical of everything he's telling him. So Doc was like, well, I'm going to feed you some things, show you some things, to prove my worth, to prove that I truly am this smart, I'm not full of crap. So Doc did, through the powers of deduction, find a woman who was missing and had been missing for 2 weeks, who was murdered by her boyfriend. Basically, the story is, if you want me to share it.
Yeah, go ahead.
The girl's boyfriend murdered her, and he had a brother that lived up in Santa Fe. And he went up to Santa Fe after he murdered her and said, hey, I killed my girlfriend. The brother turned him in. So they took him into custody. And then the killer made a deal with his attorney. The attorney said, don't tell them what you did with the body and we'll try to get a reduced charge. And that's all true. So the family of the murdered girl hired a psychic and hired a lot of people. So there were literally hundreds of people looking for this girl. I personally would go out on my mountain bike in the evenings and look for her. And I actually found her. And in the book, this is one thing that Tony, you know, he's the character where my life dictates what happened in his life. He finds her in the book, and it was Doc explains to him, you know, how he figured it out and how brilliant he was to figure out that this was the only logical place you could find her body, and Tony went to that place and found her body.
Yeah, it's very Sherlock Holmes-like level of deduction, as you said. It was interesting to me, too, because you also... You shared with me, before I even read the book, you sent me a video clip of yourself being interviewed on the local news right after you found the body.
Right.
And you sent it to me and I watched it and I was like, what the hell is this about? I hadn't even cracked open the book yet.
Sure.
So you kind of proved your worth to me before I even read the book too, in a doc-like manner as well.
Yeah.
And I think that helped me also ground myself in this book and really, that's why I asked up front, you know, how much of this is true, because from reading that up front about you finding the dead body or Tony finding the dead body, it just struck me like as, okay, So from here on out, you know, I still got 300 more pages to read.
Sure.
The ideas that are going to come up in this book, I have to use my level of discernment to figure out in my own life, you know, what resonates with me here as truth and what doesn't. And this kind of sets the table for the quantum level discussion that we're about to have. I'll tell you right up front before we get into any of these ideas, I find a lot of them to be pretty true.
Yeah.
And they make a lot of sense. Like, as you said, the science makes sense.
Yeah.
So it's not just the ideas that make sense. It's the science behind the ideas.
Right. And that's a huge motivator for telling the story, for telling Tony's story, is the science. Science, this is not, I guess you could categorize it as speculative fiction, because it's not fantasy science fiction. Not in my opinion. If you were to put it on in a library, that's the category that you would stick it in. But it's grounded in real science. Yeah.
There's a scene where Doc has won over the trust of Tony based on, you know, finding this dead girl's body. Mm-hmm. He also, at the same time, he has this passage where he urges Tony to study theology and spirituality.
Right.
And he says that theoretical physicists are fantastic storytellers with an education and a good imagination. And that made me laugh, obviously, because my view of mainstream science, especially when you get to physics level and quantum physics level, is it's all seems like bunk to me.
Yeah.
But the fact that you had a genius level scientist, a genius level physicist in a government facility telling this young entry level engineer almost to study theology and spirituality, that sets the stage for everything that comes after this.
Right.
Is that something that you were actually told?
Not necessarily, but it was something that was learned, you know, after through time, growing older, experiencing things, through knowing Doc, that he might as well have said that right up front. And there's a lot, you know, a lot of truth to that. Like the whole, well, as soon as we get into the quantum part of it, I can throw in the spiritual aspects, but. Yeah, well, there are so many people out there now that, you know, what you see on the internet or on TV, the well-known physicists, there's a lot of theoretical physicists out there that are, they have to dumb down what they're telling the public because no one would get what they're saying. So there's so many people that just have a one-inch deep understanding of physics based on what you hear. So the well-known people now purposely can't get deep into the whole physics of it because 99% of the world aren't going to get it. And I can't get that deep. I'm not a physicist. You know, I've learned a lot. I know a lot. But as far as depth, I'm not going to go that deep. Like, you cannot lay out an equation in front of me. I cannot look at that and tell you exactly that is a deviation of the special theory of relativity or something along those lines. So.
Well, yeah, and as much as you know, I know even less. So, but I, like I said, to use a pun, I gravitated towards the ideas in this book. They really resonated with me. I'm just using puns all over the place here. The meat of the book now that we're going to get into is Doc has these binders of notes, all right? Just tons of notes that he wants to entrust Tony with safekeeping of these notes.
Yes, because they're valuable. Tony doesn't know what value they have and doesn't want to keep the notes at first. He's like, yeah, I don't know what you're... He knows he's getting pulled into something. He doesn't want anything to do with it.
Right. Now, the binders contain notes on, and I wrote down some terms and phrases here that are in the book that are supposedly in these notes that Doc has. We're talking about quantum ether. We're talking about harmonic resonance, vacuum energy, dark matter, wave function collapse and frequencies, the Dirac C. Did I say that right? Is it Dirac?
The Dirac C or Dirac, it doesn't matter.
Okay.
Yeah, the Dirac C. Basically, as far as vacuum energy or dark energy, you know how you can put two plates, like two steel plates together and push them together, but you feel like there's a bubble of air in between them?
Yeah.
That's the energy inside there. And they found that when you empty a vacuum and you supposedly take everything out, it's not actually empty. There's quirks and anti-quirks and electrons and things popping in and out of existence in something called the Dirac C. So this is all just fundamental parts of quantum physics, along with the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, which is, you know, there's a certain constant of energy that exists that radiates all around us. And the Heisenberg uncertainty principle is something used to take away the effects of that energy when you're measuring something, because it serves as interference. But wave function collapse really is a very interesting thing, because that comes back to the whole notion that we create our own reality. And the way that works is, in quantum physics, you know, you can have a particle or a wave that exists as a particle or a wave, but yet it exists in both states as a particle or a wave. And it only becomes a particle once you observe it. If you're looking for a particle, that's what it becomes. Likewise, it becomes a wave if you're looking for a wave. So it collapses and becomes the one thing you're looking for. So this is the whole notion of, you can create your own reality based, you know, scientifically, as far as wave function collapse. So you create the thing that you're looking for. I could give a better example.
Oh, go ahead, sure.
Well, there's the Schrodinger's cat, which a lot of people have heard about that in science. It's basically, you have a cat and you put it in a box, a box that you cannot see through, the cat can't see through it. Inside the box, you have a radioactive decay going on. And when that radioactive decay happens, a poison gas is released. The poison gas will either kill the cat if it's released, but you don't know at what time exactly or precisely the radioactive decay is going to happen. So the cat's either dead or alive in the box. You don't know until you open the box and observe it, what its true state is. So that's kind of along the same lines as we observe reality and create reality based on what we observe.
So. Absolutely. And we'll get more into that idea here soon, I think.
We should. There's a lot more about that I could tell you.
Before we go any further, I have 4 pages of notes here, so I'm trying to keep the conversation cohesive and also maybe sort of chronological throughout the book, because it does kind of unfold.
Yeah.
To use a nice little quantum term there, it unfolds throughout, you know, in terms of these ideas just kind of build off of each other as the book keeps going. There's a great quote from Doc here around this time that Tony is first being approached about safekeeping these notes. And the quote is, you know, Doc says, "My notes are proof positive we are destroying your physical and spiritual world. I'm not talking about environmental issues or morality or brutality or any of the other things that attract protesters. I'm talking about erasing your universe, turning it into a vacuum populated by dark matter, and I have proof it's happening." That's essentially what's in all these binders, what's in all these notes, is this proof that the universe is being erased.
That's exactly right.
Where did that idea come from? Is that what you were told at Los Alamos by this Doc-type character, or is that something you took liberty with?
I think anybody could come up with that. If you really think about what we're doing, if you truly understand the foundation for existence, the foundation for all of matter, and if you really look at it, I think anyone could come to that conclusion that, hey, we are destroying everything. Basically, you know, what they figured out through quantum physics is the foundation for everything, the building block of everything, is not these concrete little blocks or these little atoms that you see or everything built together or clumped together. It is this resonating energy that actually carries information, that is the root of everything. It is the fabric of space and time. It is the fabric of the universe. And if you continue to bombard that fabric, an intelligent material, with frequencies and send electrons zipping off at the speed of light in every direction, you're destroying it. And that foundation, I mean, you can just look at anything where we upset the balance in nature, any place that we've inserted non-native species of plants or non-native bugs, it's all gone wrong. Just a few years ago, we went to Utah and we went horseback riding. We were on these arroyos, which are dry ditches. Basically, they had a royal erosion problem around these creeks, and they were trying to save the banks. So they brought in these plants that were supposed to save the banks. Well, what these plants did is they took over all the banks. They just killed the native species, and they leave a salinity in the grounds. They upset the whole balance of everything because they're making it salty. And the way they absorb the water, they made the problem twice as bad. they take up the water. So it's just, you know, one example. There's just millions of, maybe not millions, but there's too many to think of examples of where man interferes with nature and disrupts everything.
Well, speaking of disruption, this is the point in the book where you introduce the Taos Hum.
Mm-hmm.
This is a term that I think a lot of people in this conspiracy world would understand or at least know of. But for those that don't know what that means, could you describe what that is?
Yeah, it is. I've personally experienced it. It came about in the early 90s. People up in the Santa Fe and Taos, New Mexico area started hearing this, what they described as a hum that was disrupting their lives. It was keeping them up at night and nobody could figure out what it was. But I had heard all the reports, never heard it or anything. Then I went camping up in that area and I heard it. It was loud. And I'm like, what? There's a train out here. Are there train tracks out here? We couldn't, there were no train tracks. We were in the middle of the mountains. Person with me also heard it very clearly. And we're told, hey, that's it, man. That's the Taos Hum. It's like that. It was more of a mechanical rumbling than a hum. It was a disturbing noise. No one was ever able to pinpoint where that hum was coming from. However, it's right there near Los Alamos Labs. And Los Alamos Labs, you know, that's a very famous facility. But along right. with the University of Chicago, they created the atomic bomb. And so that's where all these top secret programs take place. So everybody just assumed it was coming from the Los Alamos. They were working on a project. And the only place I've heard it is Taos, but it's said to be heard at different locations around the world.
You can hop online. If you search Taos Hum, you'll find that it's not just in New Mexico. There's people hear this hum all over the U.S. and, like you said, all over the rest of the world too. Now, the origins of this, yeah, nobody's ever really figured it out, but there is some information in the book. I don't know if it's speculation or not, but there's some information in the book that says it may come from DOD programs and that it may have
claims,
to...
That's right. The book claims that it's coming from Department of Defense programs. And the program is a program that is used to send frequencies, energy, basically, into the atmosphere and into space that they're shooting. And it's not meant to be heard, but it's at the point of origin, there's some overlapping waves which cause it to be heard by the human ear. It will rumble at a frequency that people can hear it. So it is in the book said that it is coming from a specific program at Los Alamos Labs.
Right. And some of the other terms here that you mention in this section about the origins of the Taos Hum are... You mentioned how it could send energy, but I do think you started to say that it could send information, and that seems to be true as well. Quantum communication is something you mentioned here, quantum computing as well. You mentioned irregularity in frequencies, frequencies of the Earth and of the human body. And then there's an interesting correlation here, too, with this facility in Alaska that a lot of people will know as HAARP now. They'll know it now as HAARP. Back then, it wasn't named. Yeah. Back then, it wasn't even built. They were just breaking ground on it, right?
That's exactly right. They're breaking ground on it. And in the HAARP program in Alaska, the program that originated at Taos was then the program that got the HAARP and everything started in Alaska.
Yeah.
And that is, you know, there's all kinds of information about what HAARP truly is. But what it's known is, it is known that it is shooting high-powered frequencies into space. And there are many things that can be used for. It can be used to knock down communication systems in other countries. It was originally built to knock down missiles from Russia, supposedly. But there's a lot of other things that it can do because these frequencies disrupt the foundation of everything, which is that resonating energy that sustains all of life. But there is total disregard by the government for what's happening at that level, that quantum level, to this energy, this quantum ether. There's no studies that have been done or anything. As far as the HAARP program goes in Alaska, they have kind of farmed it out to some universities lately, made it more of a private thing. I'm not sure how much legally you can even say about it in a book now, the fact that it's becoming privatized. However, there's tons of information about it. And that DOD program that started HAARP did not disappear by any means.
From what I know about it, and I've read a bit about it prior to reading your book, but is that there's this HAARP facility in Alaska, and this stands for High Active Auroral Research Program. Is that right?
That's right. Yeah.
High altitude.
High frequency. Okay. Auroral Active Research Program.
All right. So it stands for that, but
yeah,
it's just one facility in Alaska, and that there's others like it throughout the country as well that just aren't well known, well publicized. And then there's another interesting correlation here too, because Doc mentions as well, or maybe it's not Doc, but it's mentioned in the book, that in conjunction with HAARP-like facilities is that there will be relay stations for these signals and frequencies built around the world. And you don't mention this term in the book because I don't know if it's what these relay stations are or not, but have you heard of the term Gwen Towers?
No.
Interesting. Okay. Well, oh man, I wasn't prepared to explain it, but
we don't have to.
Well, what I'm saying is that they could act like the relay stations. If you saw a picture of one, if you Googled Gwen Towers, you would know. You would have some probably near where you live right now.
Okay. Well, they could serve the same purpose as a relay station. Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So they may, the infrastructure's there. They don't even need to. In the book, it said, you know, back at the point when it was being explained by Doc, that these facilities would be built around the world and they'd become actually small enough to put in shipping containers. You could put them behind an embassy in a foreign country. You could put them wherever. So,
well, there's one right across the street from where I live, so I'm probably getting my frequency fucked with right now. But
yeah, you probably are. Yeah. And the funny thing is, you know, growing up and everything, you hear about people with aluminum foil on their heads, crazy people. Forever, people have said they've been bombarded with frequency. There actually is something to that. That it can disrupt you being bombarded by frequencies. Your DNA, it can change your DNA. I mean, there's a biophysicist, there are some Russian physicists that did a lot of research in frequencies and what it can do. There was a biophysicist in Russia, his last name was Garjaev, I believe is his last name. I don't know how to say it. But what they did is they took DNA. You know, everybody believes that 10% of DNA is all that we use, and then the other 90% is junk DNA, so it doesn't get looked at. Well, what they did is they looked at this 90% junk DNA, and they did a test, they did experiments, and they found with modulated radio and light frequencies, they could actually change DNA. They could affect the DNA. They could affect the cellular metabolism in the DNA. They could alter it. So basically, with frequencies, you can literally disrupt cell formation and DNA in people. That information is available too. There's a lot of information that people can find if they look, dig deep. Western scientists haven't really looked into it as much as the Russians.
Well, here's the thing, man. I've recently gotten into some alternative healing practices in my own personal life, sound and frequency and things like that, and how it can heal you. So and I've seen tremendous results, to be honest, from these practices. So if healing with something like vibrational sound therapy is possible, then hurting me with it as well is also possible.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's programs right now going on. There's one going on in Toronto. I think it's called It from Qubit. And it's these conferences where people come together and they've realized, and these are physicists, this is the scientific community, that energy, the vibrational resonating energy, is the foundation for everything. And if you disrupt that, it can affect biological systems. So we'll talk about the global consciousness experiment. That kind of shows you right there that, hey, you really can affect health and things with vibrational states. And that's kind of what that conference in Toronto has proven. The whole shift in physics now is starting to show that all this metaphysical stuff that everyone thought was bullcrap is not bullcrap at all.
Yeah. And actually, I was just looking at a note right here that's mentioned in the book where it says, as your internal vibratory state or frequency changes, you unknowingly step into another dimension and encounter another version of the Book of Life. So that's kind of what we're talking about here is that these things can affect you on such a deep level such a spiritual level that you can, I guess, sort of transcend this reality, this material reality through that.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. And I was trying to think of a way to simplify it. It's a hard thing to simplify. Mm-hmm. You know what a fractal is? A fractal is there's fractal geometry. A guy named Mandelbrot came up with it. And a fractal is basically a self-similar object that repeats itself. If you take one part of it, that'll look like the whole thing as a whole. And we see that everywhere in nature. The clearest example I could give is a fern, an unfurling fern. The tips of the leaves and everything are the same parts. Well, in life, we can create, there used to be a program called Fractal Explorer. It was fantastic. I don't know, it might still be around. It was free online, where you could create these fractals, which came out of math, out of equations. And it's basically self-similar patterns repeating themselves over and over, just like nature, just like, you know, snowflakes are fractals, so on and so forth. But if you look at a fractal and you create a fractal and you zoom in on it, the farther that you zoom in, you know, it just keeps unfolding. You see a repeating pattern over and over and over. But eventually, you can't zoom in anymore. It becomes pixelated. It just becomes a blur. So you can't discern patterns or anything. And eventually, you see the blur and you can't see anything at all. Well, the fractal doesn't disappear. It still goes on. We just can't perceive it anymore because we are humans and we can't perceive certain things. Well, when you get down to the root of everything, this whole quantum ether may in fact look like a fractal. It does. And I'm kind of breaking up a little bit. Do you hear me breaking up a little bit?
Yeah, just a little bit.
I'm gonna come.
Go ahead.
Okay.
Go ahead.
I don't know if I've been. Anyhow, when you get down to the root of everything, you have this, everything comes out of this sea of energy. And that's where everything is born. Well, it could look like a fractal. Now, you could have a fractal that goes to the left or to the right. The first branch could go to the left or the right. You as a person, when you create the equation to create the fractal, you pick the equation that says the first branch goes to the left. However, the branch that goes to the right still exists as a possibility. So a lot of people speculate that in like a multiverse or multiple dimensions, that the branch that could go to the right also exists, even though you don't create it. So that's the whole multiple dimension thing. But what you have is an energy that most people believe is a designed energy. Not most people, but people are more and more believing it's an energy built out of design and not a random accident. That energy influences everything. So it influences your health. It's a resonating energy. And things like those Russian scientists that affect the DNA, they did it with speech. They actually sent speech-type patterns on these frequencies that change the DNA. It's the same thing. It's you can do it through meditation, through vibrations, whatever. You can affect that energy. If you're consistently sending negative thoughts at it, I guarantee you negative things are going to be manifested in your body or somewhere else versus, you know, positive. So,
right. And just to be clear, this energy we're talking about is quantum ether.
Mm-hmm.
And
there's a lot of names for it.
Sure.
Some people call it zero-point energy.
Zero-point, yeah.
Vacuum energy, the great field. It's been called a lot of different things.
The basic definition of it is I'm just taking this from the book because I thought it was well worded. It's a form of energy that's spiritual and is also inherently connected to everything physical. And I think that's the point we're trying to make, is that while it is invisible to the human eye, it affects you every day. And
yes,
the point that you make in the book here at this time is that we, and whoever we is, the government or whoever the government's even working for, I don't know, but some group has hijacked this energy. Somebody has hijacked these frequencies, and they're using it against us. They're manipulating us with it, right?
They've known since at least the 1950s and probably before that you can do things with this energy. They couldn't explain what type of things or why these certain things were happening. But it's been known that it's something that they better look at closely and use, you know, to their own benefit, use for power. You know, one example is there's been people that have done experiments for 50 years that show how they can hook up a plant to a sensor, and they can light a match and intend to burn that plant and get an actual response from that plant. Well, that's stuff that was considered fringe and crazy metaphysical a long time ago. It's not anymore because of this connection. And, you know, now everybody hears about quantum entanglement now. And there is connections that exist that they can't explain, but they do exist. So they've always looked at it, but it's always been done secretly. In the book, that's what speculated it.
Well, and we also know that animals live by this energy.
That's right.
You know, you mentioned some good examples in the book of different groups of animals that utilize it. Ants, starling, fish, the monarch butterfly.
Yeah.
Bees, and bees actually use this as well, you know, for migratory patterns maybe, or birds do too. I don't know.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And recently, and I'm talking within the last few months, people have started to say that birds actually have a quantum connection, a quantum entanglement type connection with the magnetism of the earth, where they can actually see the magnetic fields. And the only way that is possible was through an actual quantum connection where they literally can see it. In the book, I talk about, you know, how a group of, I think it's in the book, of starlings move as one organism because they move as if they're connected. It's just, it's the unity of the group that are all existing in this connected way, this fabric. And they're quantum connections that allow them to move like that and evade things. And the monarch butterfly thing is just always amazed me. I mean, these butterflies find their way to the exact same tree on the exact same top of a mountain. But what you don't understand is some of these are removed from that tree by several generations. They're born in North America. And they're born in the southern part of the country. That one moved north, and then it had a butterfly and blah, blah, blah. And some of these will migrate 3,000 miles to this tree on this mountaintop. They've never been there before. It was their great grandparents that were there. They're the ones that started there. So that is just an amazing thing. Now they found that, you know, scientists have said, well, they used the shortening of the day to determine the direction. They know it's time to head south by the length of time of the day. They keep the sun at a certain position. And all of that works to get you in a general direction, but none of it explains how you can get another 600 to 1,000 kilometers to the right to the one mountaintop you need to get to. So, and it's because they're all connected on this level, this quantum level. They utilize the quantum ether.
I want to go back to the manipulation of this energy because I think that's an important point to make. You know, I said that you mentioned in the book that this energy has been hijacked. You also mentioned that nature's decline began when we started blasting the quantum ether with high-powered frequencies. And not only have we cut all lines of communication on Earth and the heavens, that's an interesting note to talk about, but we are also manipulating human emotions in this dimension at this present time on this planet. Your ties with the collective unconscious are being severed. So,
yeah,
where did these ideas come from? Is this stuff that you were told, go ahead.
There's a famous psychotherapist named Carl Jung. Mm-hmm. Carl Jung, he's a famous psychotherapist, and he's shown how, you know, he did studies with people. He's the one who termed the phrase collective unconscious. And what that came from is there were people that would draw pictures of these archetypes, these historical figures, that there's no way they should have any knowledge of these figures. But yet something somehow got this information into their mind where they could put information out there that they should have no knowledge of. So he came up with this idea of the collective unconscious. There's things in our mind actually exist out there. It's not all in our brain. Well, that's what most people now, not most people, but a lot of physicists are talking about, is this quantum ether and how it actually originates in the microtubules in the brain. So our thoughts can actually influence things outside of our body. The physicist in Roger Penrose, he's a physicist, and he's the one who did a study not too long ago that showed that quantum processing takes part in the microtubules in our brain. Interestingly enough, what that proves is when the body dies, the physical body dies, that quantum processing that has microtubules leaves our brains and becomes part of this quantum ether. So we don't physically die. Our consciousness might actually leave our bodies. So our spirituality, our thoughts and everything can exist outside of our brains in this consciousness, this quantum ether. And as far as destroying it, our government has no regard in the book. Okay, I want to state that. And according to the book, has no regard for what happens to this. They just want to utilize it. And I think this leads us to something, a study that's going on at Princeton right now that's really interesting, and that's the global consciousness study. And it's been going on for over a decade now, maybe even longer than that. But what they've done is they have these, they're not random number generators, but O's and ones, like true and false. They have alignment, you know, it can either be a zero or a one. And they've found that there are global events that have taken place, like the World Trade Center's coming down, or the tsunamis, or anything that affects the planet and the emotions of the planet, where these numbers will align whenever a big global event happens. So what that tells us is, I think it's one in a trillion chance that that is happening by chance. So it actually, human emotion affects the alignment of these processors based on global events. And that's just another example of the connection that we have with everything. And that's something everybody should look up. It's online, the global consciousness experiment. It's unbelievable. And so if the government knows that global consciousness is a real thing that manifests itself physically, they can manipulate it. I mean, they could use the same frequency. They could study that. They could study certain frequencies and see if they have an effect. They could zap a country with feelings of despair. So they could take an enemy, maybe in the Middle East, and say, and this is speculation in the book, and zap the people, make them want to stand up against their leaders, make them want to revolt, have a revolution, you know. Or they could zap the people with America with feelings of passivity and happiness and contentment with their leaders, just the mood to buy, the need to consume.
Produce and consume, right? Produce and consume,
that's right.
Produce and consume. So we know, you know, based on the Global Consciousness Project and some other things that are going on around the world, I mean, we know the scientists are doing more research into the spiritual and physical connection on a quantum level. There's a religious component to this too, though. And in the book, you have this great little nugget where you say that the Bible exhibits an understanding of theoretical physics. How so?
I think that if you look at the way that it's written, and that's, I actually had at one point written down several passages that I had taken out of the Bible that clearly exhibited an understanding of quantum physics. And I wish I had kept that to share with you, but I don't have that. But well, it's just an...
How about I think you mentioned the "let there be light" phrase that's in the Bible.
Yeah,
does that apply here?
Well, sure. I mean, the "let there light be" thing, you know, a lot of people that scoff at the Bible and the words of it. It wasn't until the fourth day, or the third or fourth day, that God created the heavens and the suns and the stars. So everyone says, well, on the first day, he created light. So how is that possible? Because he didn't create the stars until the fourth day. Well, interesting enough, there's a book called the Haggadah, which has been adapted by Judaism. And there are some texts that have been edited and not part of the Bible. But some of them have picked up these old verses. And the Haggadah says that on the first day there was light, but it was a different kind of light. It was a light that man couldn't see, that allowed man to see across the universe, but it wasn't a visible light. I don't know the exact words. So basically what it's talking about is this connection of energy across the universe, the cosmos, but it wasn't the same type of light that we associate with turning on the light bulb. So that was not in the Bible. It was edited out of the Bible. So there's things like that, that you'd say it's a certain kind of light that allowed man to see across the universe. What the heck are you talking about? If you said that to someone 2,000 years ago or 1,500 years ago, they'd be like, what are you talking about? But if you're a quantum physicist, you might say, oh, it's the background radiation of the cosmos or something, you know?
Well, does that also relate to the Heisenberg uncertainty principle and zero-point energy?
Yeah, absolutely. It could be the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. It could be that energy, because light is a form of electromagnetic energy. And so in the Bible, that would be electromagnetic energy, which is a form of light. So, yeah, absolutely. So I wish I had that, what I had written. That was when I was doing research. And I had actually pulled a lot of passages out. It's like, that's quantum physics. So yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. That's a good one. Yeah.
Let's go back real quick to quantum entanglement. We touched on that just a minute ago, or at least we threw that term out there. You do mention that in the book, quantum entanglement and wave function, and how human physiological states and thoughts have an associated frequency. Moods have a corresponding waveform that can be altered by employing advanced techniques used in quantum entanglement and some more primitive techniques employing energy states, and that this is all measurable and proven. Did you learn this out there?
No, I didn't learn that out there. I learned some of it out there. The stuff I learned out there was more someone would share something interesting about something that the lab was doing or something, but it never got into the depth. But what it did is spark curiosity in me. I'm someone that likes to take things apart, figure things out, mess with electronics, stuff like that. So that kind of got the juices flowing, just things out here. Like the LIDAR. When I was out there, they created the LIDAR. And the LIDAR was a fascinating thing. It was a laser. When I was out there, it was the size of a semi-truck. And you could shoot it over a city, and you could pick up molecules associated with someone producing drugs in a house. Or you could pick up the heat trails on a stealth bomber. Well, now they've got this thing down to just a small thing. So I'm told about the LIDAR, but I don't know anything about the science behind it. So personally, I then go and research the science behind it and try to figure out, how does this thing work? So it just sparked. It sparked a lot of things. For me personally, things changed for me. My wife got ill, and she had a brain tumor. And I went through a change in life where I became more of a spiritual person. And it was because of some experiences I had. But the change was kind of an amazing thing. It was such a horrible thing to happen to my wife, but it was a great experience for who I was. I became a complete different person, and I learned a lot. The interesting thing that happened is, and this is a true story, I walked into a bookstore in Yellow Springs, Ohio, and this is when everything was going down with my wife, and things had just gone crazy, and a book literally fell off a shelf. It was a used bookstore. I hit the ground, and I picked it up. And I'm like, okay, so I bought it. And it was a book by Barrett on existentialism. So I started reading it, and then I read a couple other books on existentialism, and I got bored with it. And something changed in me that I became consumed with learning. And from existentialism, it went on to other things and frequencies, and eventually I got sucked into quantum physics. And I just couldn't let it go. Loved it. I mean, I just read everything. And I had it set up where I'd finish a book in a few days, and then my doorbell would ring, and Amazon would hand me another. So a change took place with me, and it almost felt like some sort of intervention sent my life in that direction to really get absorbed in this. And so I reflected a lot on things that had happened when I was out in New Mexico.
Let's transition a little bit away from quantum ether and that kind of stuff for just a second. Let's get into more spiritual stuff. You mentioned you have DMT, the spirit molecule, on your bookshelf there behind you. And you also mentioned ayahuasca in the book. You have kind of a humorous scene. Tony has a friend, Barry, who has an ayahuasca experience. It's funny. It seems like it doesn't go too well, but it actually turns out to be really good for Barry in the long run. But this does bring in the psychedelics to this conversation and how they play a role in accessing these realms of consciousness that, I mean, you can do it without psychedelics, but the psychedelics obviously make it a little easier to get there, right?
Yeah, I mean, you know, people, there are religions that still use them. The Sufis use them. And for thousands of years, people have used them as a connection to this consciousness, this spiritual realm, looking for enlightenment or something of that nature. But there's an actual, you know, there's some real benefits to certain non-synthetic psychedelics like psilocybin and DMT. And there's been some studies, and we talked once before about, you know, the studies that Rick Strassman did, and he wrote about it in the book DMT, the Spirit Molecule. Where they had pure DMT and people took it. Fascinating, some of the things they see, and some of these things they see are these archetypical things that, like I was mentioning, Carl Jung earlier. You know, they shouldn't see these things. They have no knowledge of these things. Their imagination has never created some of these. So it's as if they're truly connecting to something, out-of-body type connections. And the funny thing is, you know, those were the only studies that we knew of where they did use psychedelics on people, but they've actually started to do some new ones. London, they just forget the university, they just did a study with psilocybin, and now they're doing it at an institute in Santa Fe, where they're using psilocybin on people that have depression. And the one study in Santa Fe, I think they're using it on people, cancer patients or terminal cancer patients. And these people are taking one dose of psilocybin for the depression, and some of them go into total remission from the depression. And for some of them, it'll be 5 months on this one dose that they lose this depression. And the same thing happened with the studies in London. It's amazing the effects that they have on people. But these come from plants in nature. And we have the same DMT in our own brain. And, you know, I don't know, why is that there? I think maybe it helps our consciousness to go to this other place once we die, or I don't know the reason.
Yeah, I've been researching DMT for a little while now, and actually more recent information shows that it actually occurs in the highest amounts in the lungs.
Really?
Yeah. And so that's why things like breathing are so important. You see a lot of these people that, it's not meditation necessarily, but they do like holotropic breathing work, breathing exercises, these really deep breathing exercises for 2 hours. And after 2 hours of this kind of breathing, they report that during that time that they had what they would compare or what they would call a psychedelic experience that they produced through their own breath work. Yeah. So yeah, you should check that out, man. That's where
I actually have a friend in Dublin, Ohio, that he does that. He's told me before, breathing, man, breathing. And he owns a place where they do massage and all kinds of therapies. And he's always pushing the breathing, the deep breathing techniques.
Yeah. I heard a scientific explanation that I can't recount right now, but how the DMT is produced in the lungs and how it gets to the brain. I shouldn't even brought that up because I can't explain it, but it does kind of work together. But it seems like it almost forms in the lungs and then it's absorbed into the brain somehow. I don't know, but food for psychedelic thought.
Well, and you know, as far as ayahuasca, whenever they talk to people that have taken ayahuasca, they come out of it saying, you know, it was the greatest experience of their life, a lot of them. They say it's completely changed them. They have a new understanding of everything. And if you talk to people, or if you've ever experienced, you know, like magic mushrooms, people don't come off of those with a hangover. They come off with a feeling of love, you know, a new understanding for their families. They might feel a greater love for their families. That's the down. That's the come down. The come down is this feeling of connectedness and love with your family and compassion. That stuff has great effects on people.
So the psychedelic experience in the book, you know, the ayahuasca trip that Barry has, and then Tony has a mushroom trip later as well. Are these true life experiences? Have you ever done psychedelics or had, I guess, people around you that had these sort of experiences?
There's a guy, Paul Stamets, is an expert on mushrooms and mycelium, which is mushroom when it's still in its infant type form. And he's written a number of books on them. And he has some books on psychedelics. And he says in his book that everybody absolutely should try magic mushrooms. And he said that he eats it once a year, and he recommends that everybody eat them once a year. And he's a leader in the field just because of the positive effects it has on people. And I know with psilocybin, usually it's not a trip. It's not a you're out of your mind seeing things, don't know what the hell's going on. It's usually auditory effects, enhanced colors, things look differently, a warm feeling. But for some people, they find like medical value in it, where they might feel things in their body and it actually shows them something's not right there. Something feels wrong there. It's kind of, they talk to some cancer patients and they could feel the cancer inside of them when they're on the psilocybin. It pinpointed it. It was like it grabbed a hold of it. And they're like, wow, I can actually feel where my cancer is. I mean, it's great. And they've used psilocybin for treating MRSA and some other things. So, but you know, pharmaceutical companies.
Well, it's the same thing as, you know, like THC and cannabidiol targeting cancer cells and killing them and leaving the healthy cells alone. You know, like these plants are smart. These plants are conscious almost. Well, I don't think almost.
Exactly.
I think they are.
I think so too. And they were born out of this quantum ether. Maybe grew as a fractal. And so the design of these plants was perfect, but we're interfering with that design. And that's the big thing about this book. We're interfering with the design of everything. We're manipulating everything.
Let's talk about the Schumann resonance for a moment. You know, this is something that I've heard of before. I didn't really know what it was. I had seen it somewhere else recently too, but I didn't know what it was. And then I read your book and it was explained well in there. But this Schumann resonance is the regular frequency pulsation of the Earth. And yeah. It's at 7.83 hertz.
Mm-hmm.
Coincidentally, this is also the same level in the brain of hertz where alpha waves are created,
right,
or where alpha waves begin, I guess, at that hertz level.
That's right. And it's just another example of how man has gotten lost and thinks we walk separate from the Earth. We control the Earth. We are part of the Earth. We have the same resonance with the Earth. We were born out of the Earth. We're going to return to the Earth. We're part of the Earth. But we're conquering the Earth, we're destroying the Earth, and we're separate. And I'm not a crazy environmentalist. I just tell it how I see it. Just like as far as spirituality, I believe in God, but I also believe that science is pointing back to God. But I'm not a religious right-wing fanatic either. You know, I'm moderate on things. I was skeptical about paranormal type things. But, you know, this whole energy thing, as far as the energy doesn't die once our body dies, also validates paranormal. It also validates that there could be spirits among us. And you know what? There's no science out there that can disprove any of that. There's nothing that says, no, that's not real. There's nothing. So the Schumann resonance, yeah, our bodies resonate with it. Certain things affect the resonance of the body. There's certain drug use that brings down that resonance. I'm sure heroin brings it way down.
Yeah, probably.
But this energy, you know, there's so many things. Energy is, we need to control our energy, man. We need to control for our health and everything. But we allow outside influences to affect us. We allow waiting in line in Walmart to bring our energy level down. We allow all these mundane, stupid things that don't matter. So I always try to practice living in the moment and being aware of that energy. However, I'm like everyone else, man. I have bad days where it slips away and where I lose touch with who I'm supposed to be and everything else.
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, you're still just a human being that has emotions, yeah, and it's hard to ignore them some days. Just to wrap up on the conversation about plants and how it's all connected, you mentioned it in the book too, this, it's almost like a science experiment that where plants' biorhythmic responses were measured against human intentions, and that when human had a negative intention, the plant reacted to it.
Right.
Almost even before the event happened.
Yeah, and they've measured that, and there's been studies that show that's real. And that's one of the things I was touching on, that our government's known about this since way back. Longer than 50 years ago, but that's a real event and something to really look at, that, you know, figure this out and you might be able to control certain things. So yeah, there's, and that goes back to the thing I mentioned about striking a match. You have the intention to burn that, just the fact that it was an intention. And this all proves, you know, what Penrose is saying, the physicist, regarding, you know, we have a quantum connection through these microtubules in our brains. And that's relatively new science. That just came out after I wrote the book. I heard about that. I was like, wow, I already knew that. You know, a lot of this book is just things I knew and I just kind of knew. And then later on, I found the science to validate it. Like, huh, that's what I've been saying in my book. So,
right.
At the end of the book, we haven't got to that part yet. But, you know, the Chinese did release a quantum satellite after the book was put out, which is kind of interesting if you read the whole book. And I don't want to give away anything.
Yeah, you know, like, I'm trying not to spoil the plot here, but yeah,
right,
there is a Chinese character here that's interesting as the book unfolds, and we'll keep that for people that actually want to read it. But I want to dig into a few more ideas here, if you don't mind. Right. So years ago, when I first got into like fringe topics, fringe research, you know, when I first started expanding my worldview and my mindset, and I think everybody goes down this rabbit hole, is the rabbit hole of time travel.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Now, personally, I don't think time is real. It's not anything that's observable.
It's relative.
Yeah.
You know, it's relative. We perceive it as real because we see the sun every 24 hours. So we have 24 hours in a day. So that's one way to look at it as far as it being relative. But there's more to it than that. Take out the relative equation. And the book speculates that time isn't a linear process, that everything exploded out and everything that could happened is stacked in layers. So you're not flipping through time. You're not, take a 2-hour movie. Okay. You watch the movie. and you're watching it minute by minute, and you're seeing time go by. Well, if you lay the whole movie out, you open the reel and spread it all out in front of you, you look at the entire movie at one time. That's a weird way to think about it. So everything's unfolded, but we perceive time to be passing. And in the book, it says what we're actually doing is stepping into different layers, different dimensions for different consequences, but we're going to the same point in time. We're just moving through different layers. But to us, it's the perception of time. Right. It is a hard thing to wrap your brain around. I like the description of it in the book, but time is not a real thing, you know?
Well, to just keep with the term, though, you do say, you do speculate in the book that time travel is possible. It might actually be real, but you don't call it time travel. You actually call it resonance travel.
Yeah.
Which, you know, keeps with the theme of vibration and frequency that the book follows. And do you want to describe what you mean by that?
Yeah. And what I mean by that is people will regard as time travel. Actually, the book speculates that we won't actually be traveling to a different time, but we'll be traveling to a different event through resonance travel. So each event has unfolded, it's been stacked in layers at a single point. There's a present time that may be moving, but it's a single point through all these layers of possibility, but each different possibility or event or outcome, if it's something we perceived as happening in 1815, it's actually happened now, but it's at a certain event that has its own specific resonance. There's an associated resonance, just like the global consciousness experiment. There might be a certain resonance to the world when the World Trade Centers came down. And at that particular resonance, if you can figure out what that exact resonating frequency is, and you can dial in a machine to that exact resonance, you could transport to that. That's what the book is saying.
It's transporting through the use of electromagnetic waves. It's manipulating light.
Yeah.
So the individual would be transported. The individual that would be transported would have to tune their alpha brain waves.
Yes, they would have to, exactly. Their Schumann resonance type, their brain, alpha brain waves would have to be tuned to that exact frequency of that event that occurred. So in the book it says, well, then you could transport yourself to these events like in the future. But is there a future? So we won't even go there.
Yeah, I mean, if it's all happening now, then...
Right. At a higher level of sophistication on this planet, if we could tune that frequency to your alpha waves with the same frequency of the event that happened, you could possibly visit that event, but you could only visit it as an observer.
Yeah.
Because if you are a participator, you would change the frequency of the event.
You'd have to have something with you that's tuned back to your home frequency so you could get back to where you came from.
Exactly. So, and I don't know if anyone in the sci-fi world has ever touched on that, what I touched on in this book.
Yeah.
I've never seen it before, but the explanation of the book, I like it.
I like it a lot too. And it, you know, like, have you seen Interstellar, you know, touches on this traveling through this unfolded space-time, you know? I mean, that's it's the same idea. They don't use the frequency and vibration and resonance terms, probably because they would have got slapped if they did.
Yeah, that's interesting. They use curved space, and they use wormholes and thinkings of that nature. They think that you can take shortcuts through space based on curved space. But see, this is the theoretical physics stuff that I was talking about, that you brought up when we first started talking about. Hey, theoretical physicists are really good storytellers with a good education, great imagination, because they don't know. In fact, right now they are saying that they think that the universe is 93 billion light years across. So travel at the speed of light, 186,000 miles per second, for 93 billion years and you'll be able to cross the universe. Well, they're also saying that the universe is flat. So remember when we said the planet was flat?
Yeah.
Because we could see the horizon and it looked flat.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the thing is, we can only see to the particle horizon in the universe. And from our vantage point where we're looking, the particle horizon from us to that looks flat. So it could be so freaking huge, the universe, that this 93 billion light years could be way off. Because it's so big, we don't even see any curve starting when a lot of people say, hey, the universe is a bubble. They're saying the universe is a bubble with a layer around it that vibrates and resonates. Deepak is saying that. The cuckoo guy, what's his name?
Is that what they're calling the firmament?
Yeah.
The same idea?
Yes.
Okay. So that's almost like the dome idea.
And they're still saying, and they're agreeing that it is resonating. I mean, a lot of physicists now are saying that they're calling God music, because they're saying there's the notes of the universe, this vibrating notes, it's songs, and it's out of design. So they're calling God music. They're saying God is music. Music transcends this dimension that we're in. Where does music go that we're playing? It doesn't just stop with our ears. It actually can leave this dimension.
I mean, it continues to vibrate somewhere that we just don't have access to.
Exactly.
Right? You know, one more note on the resonance travel.
Mm-hmm.
Is it possible that visitors from what we would say outer space, aliens, extraterrestrials, is it possible that it's actually just human beings that are returning to this particular resonance in time to observe whatever's going on here?
That's exactly right. I mean, all these alien encounters, people think they see spaceships or whatever. It could just be us from the future coming back to look at special events. Or maybe we're sophisticated enough that we can change events. Maybe we came back and seeded Neanderthal man with some sort of gene or DNA that made us advance until they find the missing link. I mean, that's a real possibility. So it could be us. It could be us coming back and looking. Who knows?
The extraterrestrial hypothesis, it doesn't really jive with me anymore. I'm sure there's life elsewhere in the universe.
There has to be.
It's mathematically impossible for there not to be, but...
Absolutely.
You mentioned, too, in the book, that, and I agree with this, is that we're not that interesting. We wouldn't be interesting enough to come visit.
Yeah.
And if they wanted to destroy us, they would have already done it.
That's right.
So,
like I think I said in the book, they could just send a little metallic capsule with a germ inside that would destroy our whole planet.
Right.
And they could just send that from anywhere. Yeah, I don't think if they have the sophistication to travel here, I don't think they would find us interesting enough, because they've been here and evolved from this. And what they're saying now is, in our solar system alone, the most conservative estimates based on the scattering of stars and planets that are assumed to be in our galaxy, that in this galaxy alone, there are at least 100 advanced civilizations outside of, you know, that aren't on the Earth, just out there. And that is extremely conservative. I mean, there could be tens of thousands. They don't know how big the universe is. They don't know how many universes. There could be 100 billion separate universes. So... yeah, there's life out there.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, even if it's just bacteria, I mean, that's life. That's how, I'm assuming that's how life started here, so.
Yeah, but they're saying, I mean, they're actually, that Tyson guy just came out with a new book.
Oh, Neil Tyson?
Yeah, yeah. And I'm actually going to read it.
He's kind of a shill, though, isn't he?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. He's one of these talking heads that are the experts in the field, but he doesn't really present you with a lot of depth. However, what he's saying in this new book that he's come out with is that he finally does give depth. He goes into explanation. You know, he explains physics and more than, hey, there's 11 dimensions. And everyone just stands there and goes, well, there's 11 dimensions. And anyone can tell you there's 11 dimensions.
Yeah.
If you ask them to explain it, they can't do it. So, yeah, he's the one that said that there's actually, in this new book of his, 100 conservative advanced civilizations in our solar system, based on the likelihood of a planet being that close to a sun.
Well, I still don't know about that, just because if Neil Tyson's saying it, I have to question it, you know, like, because like you said, he's the talking head of the physics community, the scientific community, you know, him and Bill Nye. And Bill Nye came out last year sometime and endorsed GMO crops, and I was done with it. I mean, I was kind of skeptical of everything up to that point, but once a scientist endorses GMOs, you're bought and paid for, and I'm done, man.
Oh, my God.
I'm done.
Say, if you ever turn on Good Morning America or any of those morning shows, they'll talk about, hey, an advancement in some medical thing. And every time it ends up being a pharmaceutical pitch person. It's like, are you kidding? Every time.
Yeah.
It's, you know, they're going to pitch the benefits of aspirin. It's like, well, who do you really work for? And then you dig into it. Oh, they're actually a doctor for the pharmaceutical company.
Right.
Those guys are a lot smarter than me, but I agree with you, everything you just said.
Well, I just like the idea that, you know, everybody you see, whether it's a politician or a scientist or the Pope, that they're the public figure, the talking head for someone else.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I like that idea. Let's get back to just some more quantum stuff just real quick. We touched on zero-point energy, quantum ether. I think you mentioned just in passing earlier in the conversation that matter is only mythical. What do you mean by that?
Well, that comes back to the wave function collapse. The fact that it could be born out of our own consciousness. We perceive it and we give it its reality. Like I was saying about it, we're looking for a particle, we see a particle. But people have been saying, physicists have been saying that there has to be a basic foundation for everything, a structure that exists in a lower dimension. And that's the thing, like I was saying with a fractal, if you go through, you can see the blur that becomes pixelated and you can't see anything, but still exists. Well, it's born out of something, and it's born out of a lower dimension. So there's actually this quantum ether layer and nobody knows how it works, so this is all speculation. But it's spitting out everything, and it's spitting out electrons and everything else that's coming out of this quantum ether. But it actually be spitting out things based on what we are doing here or what our consciousness is thinking, because our consciousness is part of that substrate that exists out there that's quantum ether. It returns there. And my mind's going crazy because I'm thinking of a lot of different directions I can go with this.
Right.
One direction I could go with this is, have you ever heard, what was that, Torrid, in 1954, I think it was Torrid was the name of the country. There was a traveler, a businessman that went to Japan, and he had gone there on business trips several times before. And to this day, everything I've ever read says this really happened. There's no one that's ever disproved this. So this guy shows up at the airport in Japan, and then the customs people thought he looked a little strange. He was a well-dressed businessman, and they stopped him. They asked him for his passport, and he gave him a legitimate passport that said he was from the country Torrid. I know I'm probably saying that wrong, but anyhow, Torrid's on the border of Spain and France. And they're like, well, actually, there is no country Torrid. And he's like, yeah, there is. And they got out a map and pointed to this one. He's like, no, that's where my country is. And they're like, no. And he said, yeah, I'm here to see this company. They call it the company. The company doesn't exist. They put him up in a hotel. They watched him. They stationed someone from customs outside his door. They kept his documents, his passports. Well, supposedly in the morning, he was gone. He vanished. His passport and all his documents vanished. And to this day, and this is one of those things everybody's going to go, oh, bull crap. I still can't find anything that ever says that didn't happen. So this goes back to the thing that maybe this guy was from another dimension or a parallel universe, or our lives take different paths. So what I'm getting at is, let's say you get down to this quantum ether that everything's born out of. It's an intelligent ether. And you, yourself, your consciousness was born out of this ether. But what if out of that ether, you don't have all of your consciousness? What if somebody else, another you, was given part of this consciousness from that same ether? And that other you is existing just in a different, making different choices. Like tonight, I had the choice to get on here and talk to you, or I could have gone and played Battlefield 1. So,
have you Damn, played Battlefield? I would have played Battlefield, to be honest.
Yeah. So I made a choice. So my life is now going this direction, whereas it would have gone another direction. But what if your consciousness actually has given rise to other yous and other dimensions? I actually just thought of that today. But it's a possibility. So
hold on. Could that maybe explain dream states as well?
It could, yeah.
Where we're just kind of observing our other lives through the dream?
Maybe.
Consciousness, maybe?
Yeah. Could be. You could be tapping into that consciousness. That was just in my head an explanation for how could this be. So it works for me.
I find some credence to it, yeah.
Have you ever had anything pop into your head and you're like, where did that come from? I did not have that knowledge.
All the time.
Yeah, it's like that to me came from the collective unconscious. It came from that quantum that resides in what I call an ethereal library that exists outside of our own brain. But out of that, there's a spiritual foundation to all this too, because based on, and you read it in the book, I don't think it's chance that we're here, that this is a random accident. I think it's from design. So that matter could be coming from what I say the arm of God, because think of how unlikely it would be that all this was just a random accident where the perfect amounts of helium were spewed in, the perfect amounts of gravity were, perfect amounts of acceleration, of carbon, of oxygen. All of it had to be perfect down to the, you know, the last decimal point. And it all comes undone if it isn't, if it, it wasn't perfect. And I think one example I use in the book is, you know, if you were a God, the all-powerful, the almighty, and you could do anything, would you pick one instrument in an orchestra, that one instrument being Earth, and put all of your energy into that? Or would you basically be part of every instrument in an orchestra and experience all of it? And so I just believe that that a God would certainly, we wouldn't be just us. There could be other dimensions, other versions of us. It's all connected. Part of that light in the Bible.
Yeah, if zero-point energy is intimately tied to human consciousness, if Earth is inherently tied to the spiritual realm, but if there are people manipulating these things, these fields, consciousness, yeah, quantum ether, whatever you want to call it, what can we do about it? Do we have the power to change our own frequency and overcome this?
We have the power to change our own personal frequency, no matter how dire the thing has become on this planet. And let's say it just goes out of control and there's nothing we can do as the citizens of this planet to save the direction it's going. You can still save yourself from the destruction by focusing on your own personal resonance, your own positive energy, your own light. And because that's not going to die, that's going to carry on. So regardless of what happens here, you can just look out for yourself too. So that's kind of a message in the book.
Yeah, absolutely. I just have a few more questions. They're actually smaller questions. It could be things that are easily explained in a sentence or two from you. Studying electromagnetic radiation from people, which is what some new age types might call auras.
Right.
You speculate in the book that we have spectral equipment that make auras visible on a monitor, and so people can use this equipment to see people's auras.
Absolutely.
What would be the point of that?
Well, they have done studies to look at people's auras, and they have seen that certain events will affect a person's aura. And auras, a lot of times with this equipment, come across as colors. Certain colors are associated with certain emotions. So studies have been shown where they've seen people's auras changed based on things like pictures they've been shown, disturbing images and things. Their colors might lose distinction, that type of thing. So that then shows the same connectedness to everything that you could affect. You could find certain frequencies with like a potentiometer. You could dial into a certain mood. And if you could figure out what these frequencies are associated with these certain moods, you could project that on a large scale over the planet and affect people's moods. That's what's speculated in the book, anyhow.
Okay.
And they do have equipment that I think is commercially available. I think ghost hunters use stuff like that, where they look for auras and things like that, certain energies.
Well, I know they look for electromagnetic spikes, like EMF detectors, but... I'd never heard of things that could pick up on auras, but I guess, it makes
actually,
sense.
Yeah, I think I actually saw something one time where they were interviewing a psychic and they were showing her colors around her auras, her different colors. And the psychic was was reading someone. And they showed that she reached out and touched the person and like took some color. It's kind of amazing, but yeah, there's definitely equipment out there that does that. I don't know how it works.
Could you talk a little bit about the 777s? Is that something that you want to get into?
Yeah, we'll just say that in the book, the 777s play a part where they're kind of a rogue contractor that works with the Department of Defense. And these guys have a license to do anything they want as far as breaking into your house, tapping your house. And what they do is top secret, and they are under contract. So they do contract work for the government on the shady side.
Of course. that's interesting. You mentioned they have super user security clearance. That, like you said, full access to any and all secure whatever.
And they're called the 777s because it's a computer operating command.
Right.
777. It's a CH mod 77, which means read, write, and execute. If you're on a server, that command you can read, write, and execute. It's permissions that you give. Right. So that's why they were the triple sevens.
Okay.
Just like it's a command 666.
Yeah.
But that's the authority to read and write and not execute. There's a joke in the book about that.
Yeah, there is actually.
Smart person like that. Giggle. Now, smart person.
That actually brings up a good question, too. What role does numerology play in all of this?
Expand on that, would you?
Do numbers have power?
Numbers, I think that you can find a mathematical design to everything. I don't know as far as power associated with numbers. I don't know as far as numerology, like associated power with a number.
Well, you see, like, you know, like the number 33 is supposed to be important to like Freemasons. And this, I think, ties into sacred geometry as well. But just always wondered if numbers, when you see them, like I know that they exist in nature, these geometrical patterns and
absolutely
whatnot.
And
but
the fractal geometry.
Yes. Yeah. But when you're talking about just seeing random numbers in your life, on your like in your day to day, if they have some significance, you know, does the number 33 really mean something, or is it just sacred to this secret society? Or when you see the number, when you see triple sevens, it's supposed to be like this sort of angelic meaning, or you know, right. It has associated meaning with it. I just wondered if you ran into that during your time at the lab, or
I didn't. And that did not influence the triple sevens, that group. It wasn't based on any type of numerology. I have heard of what you're talking about. And I've seen some interesting things about number nine and power associated with it. I'm a person that believes there are no coincidences. And you need to observe every coincidence as, hey, it might mean something. But as far as numerology, I'm sure I could really get fascinated and dig into it and find some stuff, but I've never spent much time looking at it.
Well, speaking of numbers, tell me the meaning in the book of the number 1,462,503,691.
Okay, so this broadcast is not video, correct? When people see this, it's just audio.
Correct.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. I actually have it tattooed on my hip.
What does it mean, though?
I cannot share that with you.
Okay.
It does have meaning, however. It has personal meaning. But do you have the book in front of you?
Yeah. It's on the back cover, I see.
Yeah. But on the back cover, you'll see it's changed by one digit.
Oh, yeah. You cross out the one at the end, and it's a zero.
Yeah. Okay. And I don't want to give too much away, but there's a chapter in the book that's the title of the chapter is that number.
Right.
But you'll see that number has changed by one digit when you look at the back of the book.
Didn't actually realize that it had changed on the back.
Nobody's going to realize that. The only people that are going to realize that are the people I tell through you.
Okay.
So yeah, that actually has meaning in the book.
Does it have meaning beyond your personal life? Does it have universal significance?
It does not have universal significance.
Okay.
But
that's all I was wondering.
That particular number, do you remember Doc said that certain things have to happen, so many things have to happen?
Oh, yeah, that's what it was, yeah.
Yeah. Well, one of the things that was supposed to happen has happened. Therefore, that number on the back has changed. So now there's less things that need to take place.
Yes, you're right. It was like that was the amount of occurrences that had to happen for something to change?
Right. Or maybe for the planet to be saved.
Hold on. I know what it is. I know why that number went down by one. Because you writing this book was one of the things that had to happen.
That's it.
Sorry, didn't mean to spoil that for people.
Hey, that's okay. Because no one's going to catch that unless we mention it. So we mentioned it.
Right.
So nobody has caught that. So.
Okay. How about, and I don't know how much you know about this. I'd never heard of this until I read it in your book. What is X-HAARP?
Okay. So X-HAARP is in the book. The book is saying that the HAARP program that we were talking about still exists, but it's a neutered program. It is no longer the dangerous program. It's some universities are running experiments and everything. But the DOD has maintained their top secret program where they use the HAARP program, but it's this X-HAARP program. It's the extensible HAARP program where they've added stuff to it. They're in sole control, and they use it. And they use it to manipulate certain things like human emotion on a great scale, like knocking out all of the communications in a city where Osama bin Laden is hiding. There's a number of things that can be used for. But again, these frequencies are disrupting the balance of everything, the duality.
Yeah, and I'm big on duality. You know, like I said that up front. I tell people all the time, you need balance in your life. Duality is important. You know, male, female, black, white, light, dark, good and evil. You need both sides.
And you have to recognize evil for being truly evil, mm-hmm. or else you're diminishing good for being truly good. If you see evil as just kind of that's not so bad. Well, then the good things that happen are just not so good. You need to have both. They need to be real and recognized.
Absolutely. Yeah. Tell me a little bit about Adam's gold, Das Gold.
Let me tell you a story about that.
Okay.
I was in another library I was visiting. I visit libraries occasionally in Albuquerque. Found this little crappy leather book in a library, and I took it home. And it was the Adam's Gold Diggings. This book will make someone rich someday. And I read that little thing in like 20 minutes. And it was like, wow, this is a cool story. I took it back to the library and turned it in. And this is in the book. And then I saw something on TV and they started talking about the Adam's Gold Digging. I'm like, I just had the book on that. I went back to the library. They're like, we don't have that book. Someone just left that here. It's not in circulation. It doesn't have a number. We don't have it. The book was gone. I looked everywhere. It's not anywhere in any libraries. Anyhow, I read that book might actually be worth more money than the gold if you had that book, because there are no known copies. There's not even one in the Library of Congress. And so it was a very valuable book that I had my hands and lost.
Well, the book was called Das Gold, right? And
yes.
It was written by a German that supposedly it contained information, coordinates, location of this vast gold fortune.
There's a lot of information out there that exists about this Adam's Gold, where this Adam's party went out and were killed by the Indians, and they found this rich vein of gold led there by an Apache Indian. But this information that I read in that book is not out there, and I've never seen it since, and it was a different account. And so it comes into play in the book, and it actually comes into play at the very end of the book as well. And I can't say any more about it because I'll give away too much. But it was a real book, and it was really in my hands. And it's one of those things in life you just kick yourself, like, oh, my God.
So you never tried to go find this
gold? No, I actually did. Yes,
you did?
Yeah.
Were you successful?
I couldn't say that on here.
Okay. Well, in the book, I won't spoil it.
I made a couple trips to find the gold.
Okay. I think what happens with the gold in a book is pretty awesome, though, to be honest. So I just want to talk one more.
Well, I got to say, you've done really good as far as your preparation and your questions are fantastic.
Well,
you're good at this.
I'm still learning, to be honest. It's easier when you have compelling subject and material to work with. But anyways, so back to these questions real quick. You mentioned that, okay, I don't know if I'm going to say these right, but the Sacsayhuaman in Peru, Baalbek in Lebanon, Tiwanaku, and Pumpapunku. Is this, am I saying these names right?
I don't know how you say the names, but yeah, those are real places.
So these places, the Nazca lines. Yeah, these places, the pyramids of Giza, the Nazca lines, I think you just said, right?
Yeah.
That these were actually, going back to our conversation about resonance travel, that these might have been advanced people coming back and building these sites.
Yes, they could have been us coming back and building them as monuments to tell us, hey, we are here, we came back and we did this, because their construction and everything to this day defies explanation. They do not know how primitive man could have possibly built this. The fact that they were built out of stone, all of these monuments, is because they endure time and they last. But just the way certain things were cut and placed, they can't explain it. How do you undercut a 300-ton rock? How do you make a straight line underneath without any tools, except for metal tools that are usually, back then, were all copper, so they weren't even strong enough to cut through granite. But somehow this happened. So it's a mystery. And one explanation in the book is that we came back and we were actually left these as proof that we do come back. Just like the pyramids of Giza.
Yeah.
The King's Chamber is 150 feet high. The rocks that were used around that part of the pyramid were mined 500 miles away and somehow drug 500 miles. And I forget the weight, from 3 million to 5 million, or 50 tons, 3 tons. I don't even remember. They were enormous stones. But somehow they took them 150 feet up, perfect cuts, placed them. So I guess the Japanese at one point tried to show how it was done, and they conceded. They said, we can't do it. It's not possible. Other men have come in with bulldozers and helicopters and tried to do placement of just a few stones and failed also. So maybe it was us.
Hey, I mean, it's compelling, you know, like you see a lot of ancient alien hypotheses for these sites as well.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe we're the ancient aliens, you know, maybe we're the people from outer space or that came back through time or whatever. One more thing about the book, too, before we get to your personal paranormal stuff. The meme that came out, was it last year or 2 years ago, about the dress being blue or black?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Or sorry, blue and black or white and gold. You actually touch on this in the book and what the explanation scientifically is behind that. Could you go into that?
Yeah. Well, I was mentioning how Doc has shared so many things with Tony during their experiences. And some of the things he shared with Tony, Tony's reminded of later in life. And he notices them even because of absurd things. And one of the absurd things was when this whole thing came out where half the people were seeing a blue or a gold and black dress. Some were seeing blue and white. I don't remember the colors.
It was white and gold and blue and black.
White and gold, blue and black. And it went viral. It was like, oh my God, you're seeing it different than me. Well, in the book, there was a part where Doc was telling Tony's wife, you know, look at the colors on this rainbow trout. He said, if you ever look at this, he goes, you can look at this rainbow trout. He goes, if you're looking at something like that and the colors change, you know someone's messing with you and it could be the government. He said, you can actually adjust a type of potentiometer that changes the frequency and changes the light waves that hit your retina. And then your brain will translate the waves from your retina and change the colors that you're seeing. So in the book, I mentioned that Tony says, well, I even, in absurd things remind me of Doc. And one of the absurd things was this whole dress thing. But scientifically speaking, if Doc was right, that's a true thing that could happen. Just by adjusting the frequencies of the light waves hitting your retina, your brain will translate it as different colors. So maybe it was a global experiment. Maybe not.
Crazy. That's what I thought of when I read it was, wow, was that dress just some elaborate psychological, energetic experiment?
I think Doc also mentions in the book that when a lot of experiments or things that happen with the high frequency program or X-HAARP, or a lot of times it'll be in the news that, hey, we're experiencing high solar flare events.
Mm-hmm.
So when people notice disruptions of equipment, that it could be during solar flare events, supposed.
The solar flare is the explanation that's given for the manipulation of these frequencies.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You mentioned you had some personal paranormal experiences that you wanted to share. What are they?
Well, I just, you know, we all have things that happen in our life that regardless of the science that we've learned or the things we've read or the things we think we know, you know, personal things happen to you and it changes the way you see the world. And I just wanted to share, as far as the book has an underlying paranormal element to it, that if you read it, you'll see it. And we touch on the fact that matter may be mythical, that it's spiritual in origin and creates physical matter. But the fact that spiritual things do exist, I had an experience where I was helping my family manage an apartment community, a complex. And we had this tenant. And this tenant, when I sat down and did the lease with him and I did the papers, he seemed okay. He had a guy in there with him that seemed very decent. And he was vouching for this guy. And when we signed the lease, towards the end of the lease, he said something that kind of like, oh, I may have made a mistake leasing to this guy. I don't remember what he said exactly. Something about, you ain't seen nothing yet. Anyhow, I end up leasing the apartment. And I start getting complaints from everyone that lives around him. Hey, this guy needs to go. He's scary. And I would say, well, what do you mean he's scary? And they would say, well, he just says things, off-putting things. He says things about you that hurt you. And I'm like, what do you mean? And so they would say, well, he just says things. So anyhow, I had an encounter with him. I'm like, look, you know, you're bothering everybody. You're scaring the tenants. What are you doing? He got real upset with me. And he started talking about he sees holographic men. And I'm like, okay. And I'm shaking my head. This guy's nuts. So anyhow, that conversation ends. Things get worse. He starts putting wires through the screens and doing all kinds of strange stuff. So I have it out with them. I'm like, look, man, you're going to have to move because you can't just kick someone out because they're saying weird things. You have to have a real good reason. You're scaring people. So he came after me. I said, have you seen any holographic men lately? And he said, yeah, I saw him last night. And I said, okay. And he said, you saw him too. I'm like, no, I didn't. He goes, yeah. He goes, they got you. So they got you last night. It was like midnight. And he pointed to my stomach or my lower abdomen because they got you right there. I said, what the hell? You're crazy. Anyhow, it turns out he ends up making threats, telling other people that he's going to kill me and some other things. So I go to mental health and I'm like, look, we got this guy living in our apartment and he's crazy. And they can't release information, but they're like, oh, yeah, okay, we know his name. We've actually been looking for him for 6 months. Mm-hmm. We're going to get him out. Yeah, and they said, we need him. And I told him that he had threatened to kill us. So the police went and removed him. So they took him away, put him in mental health. It turns out where he pointed and said, they got you right there, is where my tumor was, where I ended up with cancer.
Holy shit.
Pointed to the exact location. And when he said, they got you last night, like midnight, I woke up with a stomach ache that night. I didn't want to say anything to him. So he said other things, too. So I didn't know I had cancer or anything. So his uncle comes and meets with me. He's like, I need to move stuff out of the apartment. And I said, hey, man, he says things that are scary. I said, really freaks people out. And his uncle said, yeah. He goes, let me tell you what happened. He goes, I was riding in the car with him, and he started crying. And he said, I'm talking to Auntie. And the uncle said, and he goes, Auntie's dead. I said, Auntie's been dead. And he said, and Auntie was saying that the bill, the insurance bill, is in the top drawer to the left, and you need to pay it. And I was like, that's crazy. He goes, well, I opened the drawer, and he goes, and the insurance bill was in there that I needed to pay, so he wasn't wrong. So now I'm like, wow, this is scary. Anyhow, I find out that I have tumor in that exact same point where he pointed later. He also told me how I was going to die.
What?
Which, yes. So anyhow.
Holy shit. Okay.
So that opened up a whole new realm of reality for me, that this guy could do this, and this guy who's supposedly insane. So I have a philosophy that he may not be insane. He may just not be able to filter out the information that's coming into his consciousness from the quantum ether, if this collective unconscious exists. So he's getting bombarded with images that he can't control. And so he sees things, and that would also validate the no time thing. Like, that would be the future, but to him it's not. Because maybe that's the same thing with autistic kids, because they feel like they're bombarded with stimulation and too much sensation and noise in their head. Blah, blah. Maybe they just don't have a filter either. The filter is broken. So anyhow, this is how, life starts, and the book starts this way. The foundations in science, and as it progresses, certain things start to become more of a spiritual understanding. And the science starts pointing that way, and experiences in life start pointing that way. I wanted to share that because that's just a mind-blowing story.
It is, absolutely. And that's not in the book. You just shared that because you wanted to, and I appreciate that. I got one last question for you, Craig.
Uh-huh.
What does love have to do with this?
Well, love is the one frequency. There's an associated frequency with love. And in the book, it states, Doc claims that there is no way that you can destroy that particular frequency, and that love is only manifested within human consciousness, and it exists after you're gone, and it's out there, that all you really have or leave behind is this love, and you need to hold on to it, because that's what transports you from this world. That's what, when your physical body's gone, that's what exists, and that's what goes on. And so Doc is just saying that love is the one frequency that scientists cannot, the Department of Defense cannot duplicate. It is created solely in human consciousness, and it is non-destructive. It's the one thing that lives on. That's also in the Bible, in more than one place. So
they can try to cut us off from all of this, but they'll never be able to cut us off from love.
That is the point, yes, sir.
That's a nice, encouraging, positive note to end on.
I agree, yeah.
Craig, dude, thanks so much for your time. We stayed a little longer than you probably anticipated, but it was a great conversation, and we didn't even touch on some of the things I have in my notes.
Yeah.
But I don't.
We'll have to talk in person sometime, because there's a lot of other stuff I could talk about as well. But I'm glad I like what we touched on. I'm glad I got to talk to you. Glad you enjoyed it.
Well, thanks so much for your time again, and I would love to meet up, cup of coffee, maybe a burger, right?
Yeah, maybe a burger.
Yeah.
At that one place.
Yeah, absolutely. This is one of the best conversations I've had in my entire life, to be honest. I just love everything about the ideas, and
great. It's
really hit me at a point in my life where I'm starting to understand everything better, you know?
Yeah.
And I've been learning a lot about vibration and sound in terms of how it affects your health and using it to better my own health. It
absolutely does. Absolutely. So, and, you know, that's great that you have so much interest in this and that you're learning so much, because you know, for some people, it takes a knock in the head. Or for me, it took some traumatic experiences for me to really start to understand everything. But once that I learned that there was this connectedness, and I made myself concentrate and be aware that I'm connected and stay connected, man, it changed my life. And it's been good. It's been real good.
Absolutely.
Since then.
Well, you know, I lied. I have one more question for you.
Okay.
The personal aspect to all of this, you know, with your wife's health, with your own health, you do touch on in the book that you changed your mindset from negative to positive, and it made your life better.
And it wasn't even me that changed it. It was a force. I had totally hit the bottom, and I had given up. I had thrown in the towel. I'm like, you know, I've done everything I was supposed to do. I went to college. I studied hard. I tried to get a good job. You know, I wore a nice suit. I'm good with people, and I just fought and pounded my fist on this wall trying to make it work. And when it was all said and done, everything just crumbled. Health was taken away and just fell apart. And I was like, what, you know, what did I do wrong? And I realized I don't really control anything. And I threw in the towel. And as soon as I threw in the towel and I gave up, I was overcome with the feeling of peace I can't explain to this day. I was picked up, man. My life was changed. And from that point on, man, I've been a different person. And for a few years after that, it bugged people because I was too happy. I felt too good. It did. And people were like, what's his problem? He should be depressed or whatever. And I was in a great mood and thought I'd lost it. But, man, so it wasn't even me. It was I took a big thump into learn what I had to learn. But it changed me, and then I tried to make sense of it all. And I don't think we ever truly reach enlightenment, because the fact that you try to reach it defeats it, because it's something that has to happen without you consciously trying. So
that's an interesting look at that. I would love to be enlightened, but I think you're right. I think it's like with life, the more you try to do something, like the less you really actually accomplish it. You know?
Yeah, I agree with
it's,
you.
It's only when you just let go.
Yeah.
That you find what you're looking for. It's like when you lose your fucking car keys and you look all over the place, and then once you stop looking and you just let go of it, that's when you find them.
You're exactly right, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Well, Craig, take care of yourself, man.
All right. It was great talking to you.
Great talking to you as well, man. Have a
good
night.
We'll talk again. We'll do the coffee or something.
All right, man. Take care.
All right. See you later.
Bye. Ooh-wee. That was something, I think. I really enjoyed that chat. It's a difficult conversation to unpack and summarize, though. It took me about 4 days to even settle on what the episode should be titled, because there was just so much in here. I mean, how do you summarize it in just a few words? I still don't even like what I settled on, by the way. But the things that really stuck out to me here were, and I'm going to give a top three because I like to make lists, and these are in no particular order, but the things that stuck out to me were, number one, X-HAARP. A lot of people know what HAARP is, but this X-HAARP, I can't find any information on it anywhere. But the idea that an even more secretive facility like this exists is pretty terrifying. I think maybe the most likely scenario is it's a network of facilities like HAARP, or maybe the program associated with the relay stations and such. I don't know. That seems more likely to me, unless it's just one massive facility that no one knows of, maybe in fucking Antarctica or someplace. Number two on my list was the bit about resonance travel, that is something. One of the first fringe topics I really got into was time travel. One of the topics I'd like to just sit and think about in my bedroom when I was like 15. And I heard Art Bell on Coast to Coast talk about it all the time. The whole John Teeter story, that whole thing just blew my mind. But then you grow up, you mature, you do some of your own research, and you come to a different understanding of what time is. Like Craig said, it's relative. It's not anything tangible. Calendars and clocks are man-made, and they're based off solar and lunar cycles anyway. But while time may not be real and thus unable to be traveled through, the idea that events are unfolding in a non-linear fashion, all of existence, all of everything unfolding right now, that's fucking trippy, is it not? But you guys watched True Detective, right, and heard that great rant that McConaughey went on, the Rust Cole character, about time being a flat circle. That's how this appears to me now. I don't know how you guys feel, but the flat circle, the flat plane, if you will, I'm vibing with that. Not necessarily the flat earth. That's a whole different concept altogether, I think. Or could it be similar? I don't know, actually. And number three on my list was the bit about love and it being the only frequency that can't be hijacked. Obviously, I find that to be very encouraging. I'm sure you do as well. And I'm sure you would agree with me when I say that love is the point of all of this. It's why we're here. It's our guiding light. It's God. Thou art God, as Heinlein wrote in Stranger in a Strange Land. And thou art love, which I just wrote right now. However, I don't think we can overlook the fact anymore that evil exists in this world. It is real, it is present, it's here now, and some of it, or all of it, is not only leading our world at large, but also doesn't appear to be a big fan of us, or any life forms for that matter. And you can see that with how divisive everything is, at least in the United States. I've been fortunate enough to strike up friendships with some folks recently in other parts of the world, and their perception of America is, in a nutshell, what the fuck is your guys' problem? And I have no idea how to answer that. I mean, I think I know what the problem is beyond the surface, but the problem on the surface is the majority of people here think the problem is who's in office. And it's just not that simple. Not when billions of dollars are being spent researching things like ether manipulation. I mean, come on, the person leading our country on television every night isn't the person funding this research and then apparently weaponizing the findings. But hey, what do I know? I'm just a guy who lives across from a Gwen Tower and drives to work under a blanket of chemtrails every day. My frequency is beyond jacked. Anyway, my thanks again to Craig Smedley for his time. I forgot to ask him to plug his website, but you can visit him at quantumorchestra.com. That's linked in the show notes, as is a link to his book on Amazon, if you're interested in reading it. I should mention, too, that I do get a small kickback if you go to Amazon through that link and buy anything, but don't feel obligated. That does it for this episode then, a bit longer than usual, so thank you for sticking around. Hope you enjoyed it. This is OCCULTURE. I am Ryan Peverly, reminding you to love yourself, think for yourself, and question authority. And you know what? Just love. Just love, 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 love.
This cassette.